what I want to do is focus on the real fundamental physical limits. Of course, getting down to the miniaturization and the smallest possible structures is an important aspect, but there's also a speed aspect. If you even get down to that and you get your density up, how fast can you process? The reason I'm quite keen to come back to Computerphile is I spent the first 2 years of my physics degree going, should have done computer science. And because I'm a really quite a poor mathematician, to put it mildly, but I'm, as a coder, at least back in the dim distant days of the past, I used to be okay. I started with a ZX81, got into assembly language coding, did a lot of ZX81, ZX Spectrum, BBC Micro, all that type of stuff. Used to love coding. My mantra throughout my undergraduate degree, and I was not a great student, was if I can't code this, I don't understand it. So there's a piece of physics, particularly a piece of mathematical physics, I'd always think about, how do I code this? So Fourier transforms, convolution, correlation, can I reduce this to a piece of discrete mathematics, and therefore can I actually code it? So I've always loved exploring those links between programming, coding, computers, information, and physics. Before we start thinking about limits, we've got to start thinking about, well, physically, what do computers do? What do they actually do? They take information in, and they do some computation, and they give information out. Is that a fair enough description, Sean?
Sounds good to me, yeah.
So the interesting thing is just how you define information. And there's a guy called Wheeler, who was the PhD supervisor of Feynman. But Wheeler also had this very famous phrase, which was it from bit. So the idea that the fundamental quantity in the universe is not energy, it's not matter, it's information. And what does he mean by that? Well, it's intriguing. Let's play around with these. Let's say we've got a system which is entirely what we'd call reversible. Right? What does that mean? It means that if I drop that ball, let's say, as you can see, I'm throwing it down, but let's imagine that I was actually just dropping it out of my hand and it was coming right back up to the same height. Right? That would be what's called an elastic system. There's no energy being removed. The ball is coming right back up to its same height. Its end position is exactly the same as its starting position. It's entirely reversible. There is a link to computing, I promise. So, what happens if we take some energy out of this system? And there's what we call dissipation. There's friction. The ball is squishy, so when it hits the floor, it's not a perfectly elastic bounce. It just doesn't bounce as if it's a rigid object. You know what's going to happen. It's fairly boring. Now we've got a problem, because that's our final state. That's our output. That's our output of the system. Do we have any information at all about the input? From that, exactly.
No, it's just there.
You drop it from this height, you drop it from that height, you drop it from that height, you've lost all information about the initial state. However, if there's no energy leaking out of the system, then you drop it from this height, if it was a perfectly elastic system, let's do it like that, just to pretend, then it comes back up to the same height. This is already telling us that there are interesting links between information and energy. Now, if we look at a standard, to get back into Computerphile territory, there's a direct relationship between the reversibility of the system and the information content of the output. So in the second case, when the ball's like that, energy's leaked out, the system isn't reversible, and we have no idea what the input was. So we've lost information, in that sense, has leaked out into the environment. The fascinating aspect of this is if we take an AND gate, so what we have now is a logical connection, a connection in Boolean logic to this physical problem. Because, let's set this up as a truth table. Let's put that as output, which is not how computer scientists might do it, but I'm a physicist, so I'll do it this way. So, if we go 0, 0, you all know how an AND gate works, 0. 1, 0, 0. 0, 1, 0. 1, 1, 1. Now, we've got a problem. Because for three of these outputs, we've got exactly the same. We've got zero. We've got no connection between this output. We've lost information because we don't know what our inputs were. We have a lack of reversibility. And that lack of reversibility is absolutely key in terms of the connections between the physical world and the information world, the computing world. And therefore, because we've got a connection between reversibility and energy, therefore, we've got a connection with the physical world in terms of how we do computation.
there are multiple ways of getting to zero is basically what we've got here.
Precisely. So if we've got this, we can't reverse the system to know, to work out what exactly our inputs were.
There's only, forgive me for saying this, but is that not just because we've got two inputs and only one output?
Thank you for that exceptionally perceptive question, Sean. So what was that's exactly the issue. So there's a whole host of gates called Fredkin gates, which are developed, which have three inputs and three outputs. Now, I won't go into them. You don't have to have a gate set up like this. You can have something which is called a reversible gate. And in principle, if you've got that reversible gate in place, though actually there's a difference between the physics and the engineering. Engineering one of those gates and actually changing all of computer architecture to move towards those type of Fredkin gates is going to take an awful lot of effort and an awful lot of cost. But in principle, if we could do that and if we had a perfect Fredkin gate, then there would be no energy cost to computing.
No energy cost.
Because here's the fascinating thing. What costs the energy is not the computation itself. It's erasing information.
That AND gate there, it's the logic of the data, but it doesn't show all the physical connections, does it? Usually these gates have multiple things like Earths and...
Of course.
Is that right?
And in fact, exactly, they have Earths. And in fact, how you clear these in many cases is you ground. So if you've got a 1, which is, what is a 1? Well, it's a voltage. How do you set that to 0? You actually ground it. So that's a leak. In that sense, you're leaking out to the environment. And that's what's... It's a really good way of thinking about it, because that's exactly what's happening here. This is unreversible because the information is leaking out to the environment, effectively. Or in this case, the energy is leaking out to the environment.
So you must observe it to see what happens,
yeah.
Really. Okay, so with the sort of threat of going down the route of electric engineering file, how does this relate to somebody who's perhaps using a modern-day computer?
The key thing here is because it costs a certain amount of energy to erase data, and for any computation in the way we've set up, or to lose data, particularly with these, there's an energy cost to doing this because it's irreversible. That means that is setting a fundamental limit in terms of the amount of energy that it needs to power a computer. And in turn, you know, for both environmental and also fundamental physics reasons, you know, we really need to think carefully about how we actually beat that limit. If we could beat that limit, let's say we do go to these Fredkin gates, where we really come up hard against another limit is something called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, quantum physics. So don't worry, I'm not going to go into a great deal of detail about the uncertainty principle, apart from to say this, is that too often the uncertainty principle is seen as you have a system, you make a measurement, your influence on the system is affecting the measurement and there is affecting the system, and therefore that gives rise to an uncertainty. That's not it at all. It's much more fundamental than that. There is, in quantum mechanics, the observation effect or the observer effect. That's a whole, we could do 15 hours on that. And there are whole master's courses on that. But in terms of the uncertainty principle, actually every time you play a guitar, if you do play a guitar, the uncertainty principle comes about. In a nutshell, the uncertainty principle is all about how waves behave. And once you're down at the quantum level, you've got to think about particles not just as being particles, as little billiard balls. They've got a wave-like characteristic. Does that mean they change into waves? No, that'd be far too straightforward. But it means they've got a wave-like characteristic. And therefore, the physics of waves translates all the way. It must do, because we're imbuing matter with these wave-like characteristics at the quantum level. So therefore, the physics of waves in the world around us and the mathematical framework of waves in the world around us has to move down to that level. The uncertainty principle is just this. If I let that note ring out for a long, long time, or indeed if I just whistle, maybe a whistle isn't better on, for a long time, and I ask you to tell me what the frequency of that whistle is, or we look on a signal analyzer and we look at the spectrum, we'd be able to say, particularly if I whistle for a very long time, that's at 400 hertz or whatever. And some of you, perhaps, if you've got spectrum analyzers, can even go back and tell me what frequency that was at. The difficulty is this. What if I do this? Or what if I do this? How do I describe that? What frequency has it got? And the thing is this. Wide in time, narrow in frequency. Narrow in time, and in fact, if you were to look at this on a spectrum analyzer, what you'd see is you'd need a much wider frequency spectrum to represent that chunk. So when you hear that happening, and lots of metal bands do this, what that is the uncertainty principle in action. But that's the key thing. Wide in time, narrow in frequency. Narrow in time, wide in frequency. Just get that idea. I wish I'd got that idea in my head as an undergraduate about 3 years before I did get it in my head. And then quantum physics would have been a hell of a lot easier. How does that relate to this?
Well, are we coming towards something to do with processing speed now?
We are indeed. That's exactly where I'm going with this. So the question is to ask yourself, let's say with the ideal technology, we had, you know, everything we could manufacture down to incredibly tight limits. We could get down to the single atom limit. Principle, we might even get below the single atom limit, start controlling nuclei. What is the fundamental physical principle that really limits us right down at the lowest possible level we could go to? And what it is it's the uncertainty principle. Now, often it's the uncertainty principle is couched in terms of momentum and position, for the physicists among you. There's also a counterpart, which is energy and time. At this point, what I'd really like to do is put in a little aside to all the physicists out there. So if you've got something which is wide in time, it's narrow in frequency. Similarly, if we try to constrain it in time, the problem is that we get a much larger range of energy. So if you want to do a computing operation, you've got to think about, well, the number of operations you can get per second. That means if you've got a number of operations per second, it means you've got a frequency of those operations. It also means you've got a time between those. Now, the uncertainty principle tells us that we've got a fundamental limit on how narrow we can make that time, because by narrowing down that time, we broaden out the energy associated with the operation, which sets a fundamental limit, because the narrower we get that, the broader and broader and broader the energy becomes. So that sets a very fundamental limit. And when you work it through, and there's this great paper, Ultimate Physical Limits to Computation, which was Seth Lloyd, MIT, back in 2000. This is freely available online.
Physics is physics, but this paper's 2000 and things have moved on quite a bit in terms of computing.
But the point he's making here, in fact, is he talks about having the ultimate laptop. And in fact, when he means the ultimate laptop, he's not talking about the limits. This is the important thing. There's the engineering limits and then there's the pure physical limits. His ultimate laptop is a plasma at a stupidly high temperature, and that's what his ultimate laptop comes down to. And even he talks about, let's reach in terms of the density of information. What happens if we get to a density of information which is comparable to the type of effects we have to consider when we're thinking about black holes? We are not talking about where the current semiconductor industry might be, or where it's even going to be in 20 or 30 years. We're thinking about, where are our hard limits? Where, for an incredibly advanced civilization, where are they going to stop? And it turns out that if you think about the uncertainty principle, which sets this fundamental limit in terms of the time scale, by 10 to the 50 operations per second, right? So this is operations. It's not so much clock speed, so it's more equivalent to flops.
Well, what's the state of the art at the moment for flops, then?
Thank you for asking me that question, Sean, because I looked that up, because being a lowly physicist, I wasn't entirely certain. So the Cray are reasonably confident that by 2020, we'll be at the point where we have exaflops, I believe. Let me just check that. Yeah, one exaflop by 2020.
What's exaflop?
So exaflop, exa is 10 to the 18. So 10 to the 18 floating point logic operations per second. There are some suggestions by 2030 we'll have zettaflops, so 10 to the 21 operations per second. Where's our ultimate physical limit in terms of what Lloyd has suggested? 10 to the 50, right? So 50 compared to 21 doesn't seem like a big number. 10 to the 50 compared to 10 to the 21 is a huge, huge number. In fact, if you work it through, so we're about, I don't know, let's say we're of order a meter, Sean, in terms of height. If you compare us to the diameter of the observable universe, it's 26 orders of magnitude.
So 10 to the 26, is it?
Compared to 10 to the 29. So we are closer to the size of the observable universe, the 92 billion light years, than current computing technology is.
From the limit.
Yeah, from the limit. Wow. So we've got a long, long way to go.
My little question is, why have you got some pink dealy boppers on the corner of your desk?
So if you start this off, and it puts loads of fluff, but you'd see it dissipates energy and it comes to a rest. And what's happening there is that energy's leaking out into the environment.